All right, welcome back to the show. This is the sixth episode of the Elite Dangerous Beginner's Guide series. It's been a little bit of a delay between the last one and this one, because as a result of the most recent patch, there seems to have been a pretty sizable performance hit, and I was kind of waiting for the next patch to see if that ironed it out, and it really doesn't seem to have helped much. I'm still running at north of 100 frames per second, but I'm in a enclosed area, so I'm hoping that, fingers crossed, it's going to feel good today while we're recording. But that aside, I want to get to the main topic of today's video, which is going to be how to fast track your rank grind. For those of you guys who don't know, there are there's really two factions in Elite Dangerous. Let me show you here on the status panel. You can see there we have the Federation and the Empire, both of which have a rank as well as a reputation. And then there's the Alliance that just has a reputation. Now, the Federation and the Empire both have ships that are locked behind ranks within their navy. So, for example, the Federation here, I'm Rear Admiral, which means I have unlocked every ship all the way up to and including the Federal Corvette, which you've seen me use in the past couple episodes. I like it a lot. It's not really my favorite ship out there. And honestly, I would go so far as to say that it is not worth doing the rank grind solely just to get the Corvette or solely just to get the Cutter or whatever the Empire ships are. I don't think any one single ship is good enough to justify dealing with a whole lot of grindy bitch work, because that's really what it is. And it sucks that that's the way that it is, but the rank system is pretty underwhelming, I'll say. However, there are systems that are locked behind the ranks for whatever reason. For example, Sol, the system that Earth is in, is locked behind a federal rank. You get it pretty early. But all of these, with the exception of the Founder's World, is something that I've unlocked as a result of doing the rank grind. Now, because the rank grind is so kind of painful, I was looking for a way to do it simply. Now, there's a couple of different ways to do it, but I'm going to show you my favorite. Now, if you Google around, you'll probably see stuff like the Sothis and Seos grind, which is basically you just running messages back and forth. But I like to do passenger missions, rescue missions, just because they're kind of interesting in terms of actually having some gameplay to them. You know, you have to fly into a burning station and so forth, which I'll show you all later. They're pretty easy to find. There's really not a whole lot of complexity to this method. And I'm gonna show you the whole soup to nuts pull on it. So let's go ahead and dive in. I would like to note before I do though, you'll see my Empire rank is currently 100% with rank none. I've tried this video a couple of times and it hasn't worked. I'm going to be doing it in Empire space, probably. If I end up working with an Empire faction, you will not see that rank go up. And the reason why is because I need to do a rank up mission, a Navy rank mission. And I probably won't be doing that. I'm just going to show you the concept of how to go through and quickly get to fill that bar to 100% and then I'm going to leave it to you to find your rank up missions. They're very easy to find. You just go to a, in this case, I would go to an Imperial starport and find a Empire Navy rank mission. Once you complete it, you get your rank. It is worth noting that if you decide you want to grind for like a couple of hours straight and not rank up, that experience that you gain, that reputation, will it will overfill that bar. So if I do it right now, I may have, because I've tried this video a couple of times and handed in a handful of missions, even though I'm at 100%, I may actually be at like 200%. And that extra 100% bar will be applied to the next rank, right? So your experience does not cap at 100%. You can rank beyond that. It's kind of clear as mud, but suffice it to say that you don't, once you hit 100%, you don't have to stop grinding and go find a mission. You can just keep grinding, and then you'll get a couple of rank up missions. It's basically you're just banking them so you can do them all at once. All right, that out of the way, I do want to talk a little bit about ship build. It's very simple. So going into the starport services here, I'm in a Python because I think this is probably a good ship to be doing it in. When I did this, I did it in a Beluga, and I hated it. The Beluga has these massive wings on it, and they get stuck on everything. There's stuff that you need to be maneuvering around inside these space stations, so it's nice to be using a small ship or one that you're very comfortable flying. I would recommend either the Python or the Anaconda. You could probably even do it in something like an Orca, because those ships typically run a little colder. And I'll explain why the ship being cold is important later. But let's dive right in. You'll see I have no hard points. We're not doing any combat here, so there's no point. You don't need to defend yourself. You don't need to attack anybody. Just leave them empty. Utility mounts, all of them are heat sinks. Make sure you have a bunch of heat sinks on board. You're going to need to dump a lot of heat. So just having some on board is handy. Core internals, it doesn't really matter. I would say that this is essentially an exploration ship build with passenger cabins. So make sure that your ship has some, it has the ability to jump far away, because the stations that we're going to be rescuing people in tend to be farther away from quote-unquote your home station. They tend to be on the edge of space, or edge of the bubble, rather. So make sure you can cover some distance so you don't have to jump a ton. Otherwise, some good thrusters on board is nice, but anything that you can do to lessen your heat efficiency is good. You want to make sure you're not building a ton of heat. Optional internals, this is very simple. You want economy class passenger cabins, and you want the biggest ones you can possibly fit in your ship. So you'll see here I have 5E here, and then all the way down I have economy class passenger cabins. I could lose that hull reinforcement package. Not entirely sure why I have it, but you'll also notice I have the Guardian frameshift booster. I am going to make a video about how to acquire that, because it's kind of a pain in the ass, but it's a fun process. I also have a fuel scoop here, so I could sacrifice both of those to increase the amount of passengers I can fit on board. I also have a shield. It is worth having a shield on board. You don't need the fanciest one you can get. Just get the smallest one that will fit and cover your ship from something like a bump inside a station. You are going to be hitting stuff, So as long as you're not going to destroy your ship, it's kind of nice. But beyond that, it's a pretty basic ship build, and we don't need to spend a whole lot of time on it. I guess you could say there's some freedom in the build, but it's a pretty basic activity. So now that we've outfitted the ship, we want to be able to find a station that needs rescuing. So the easiest way to do that is just going to be from the galaxy map. If I zoom out here, you'll notice that I have the bubble view on, the power play mode view. Whenever you hear somebody talking about the bubble with relationship to Elite Dangerous, they're talking about this. The bubble is the occupied human space, right? This is where humanity exists within the universe of Elite. Right. So whenever you hear reference to the bubble, this is what they mean. And you can change the map view here under this fourth panel. Most of the time, it probably just looks like this. I like to have it in power play mode because it's easy to identify whose space you're working in. And it's just handy for this kind of activity. Now, another thing you're going to want to do is under here under the options tab, you're going to want to show damaged starports. It'll bring up those special icons right here. And these guys, these starports, are the ones that are in need of rescuing. And it really is that simple. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem that we have any damaged starports within Imperial space right now, which is a bit of a shame because these will yield the most Imperial reputation right now. But what I will do is I am going to go over to, if I zoom in, oh, that's out. I will, just trying to remember, there we go. I'll be heading over to this station here in LDS 883. It's a pretty short trip, but like I said, this is why I like to have a ship with legs, because you never know when or where these stations are going to come under attack. Now, the background simulation is what's controlling this, right? So these stations fall under attack by the Thargoids, which are the aliens in the world of Elite. They appear kind of randomly. Sometimes there's some association with events that are going on in the background, but really you're going to have to kind of just roll the dice and hope that a station that is occupied by the power that you want is under attack, right? So just for sake of argument, we're going to assume that this is an Imperial controlled station. We're going to fly over there. So I will meet you on the other side of this journey. So you will notice that my frame rate is a little lower than it normally would be. We are still running north of 100 frames per second, like I said earlier, but we're not getting that buttery smooth 144, which is a bit of a shame. I'm hoping that Frontier can iron out that process or that problem a little bit later on. They do seem to be kind of slow right now responding to bugs, but now that we're getting further away from the station, we're seeing our frame rate rise. And I know, right? What a thing to complain about. I'm only getting 100 frames per second, not my 144. What's wrong with the game, right? Alright, so now that we are in our target system, we are going to be looking for a station kind of like this, one that has our kind of, imagine like a police crossing line, the hazard tape kind of thing. You're looking for that, and one that has a rescue ship in its orbit. So we see the Smith Reserve needs some help, so we're going to fly on over there. This one, unfortunately, is 54,000 light seconds away. So, enjoy getting the cut right there, but I'm going to sit here for a little while and stare at the numbers countdown. Okay, so, arriving at the damaged station here, you'll notice that the station looks a bit different than your average one. Not just because it has those big long arms, but specifically because it is on fire, which makes them a little bit unique. But just like any station, you're going to want to go in and land. But the procedure is a little bit different because inside the bay, there's a lot of fire and it's very warm. There's also explosions that happen randomly. And there's a bunch of floating debris. So you need to be able to maneuver your way around it, and that's why we got our shield, so that just in case we get hit by anything inside, we're gonna be safe from it. Now be ready when you fly in to dump a heat sink. Because you'll see your heat just skyrocket the second you get in. And then you're going to want to land quickly and keep your thumb, or well, in my case, my thumb, on the heatsink button just to keep the cockpit cool so you don't incur any excess damage. And the second you land, they're going to take you underneath into their bay. Now, once you're here, you're going to want to go straight to the passenger lounge, okay? Now, here we see we have a couple of federal factions, which is actually kind of nice because I will show you that the bar does, in fact, move. But all you're going to want to do is you're going to want to grab the ones that have rep plus 3. You're going to prioritize filling cabins with those because that gives you the most rep for your time. So just go down that list and fill up with the most high reputation reward. And that includes checking out other factions as well. So once you've got a full bay, you're going to want to go ahead and launch, and you're going to fly to the rescue ship, which is usually always 5 megameters away. Now, unfortunately, your heat is going to start building the second you decide to leave. So as soon as you get control, make sure you dump a heat sink right away.
Ship released. Hope you make it out safely, Commander.
And now here's where it's nice to be maneuverable, because you can see those big chunks of stuff just floating around. And that can hurt if you land or smash into it. So a nice note about the rescue ship being so close is you don't have to change your throttle position once you engage supercruise. Keep an eye on my throttle meter this whole time, and you'll notice it does not move. I basically just need to make sure I'm pointed in the right direction. So as soon as I'm unmass locked, we're going to charge over. And again, I'm not going to touch my throttle. I've got my hand off of it. And as soon as we get in range, we're going to safe disengage. And again, I didn't touch the throttle, not even once. So So now you want to go ahead and land, usually as quickly as possible, because these guys will actually give you time bonuses if you land quickly. So it's a decent way to make just a little extra cash to help maybe cover your damage incurred or the cost of heat sinks. It's just a nice little extra bonus. It's really not that much cash. But again, it's something to just help fluff the bank account just a little bit. If you don't get that time bonus, it's really not that big of a deal, honestly. And passenger happiness is really not a thing that you need to worry about. Because again, it's such a close flight that they're not gonna get mad at you. Or well, they may get mad at you, but it's really not gonna matter. So once you land, you're gonna head off to the passenger lounge, and you're gonna hand in all of them, selecting the highest reputation reward. Now, if you had picked up a mission that did not have a rep plus 3 reward, you wanna at least get rep plus 2, and if you can't swing that, get yourself some engineering materials, and then failing that, get yourself just cash. It should go in that order. Rep plus 3, rep plus 2, engineering materials, cash. Cash is the least important thing because this is a bad way to make money. It's really only for reputation. But now that we've handed that in, you'll see that my reputation has gone from 4% to 8% in the Federation. And you literally just do this over and over and over and over again until you're ready to rank up. It really is that simple, and it unfortunately really is that boring. Hopefully this helps you. It really did help me get through the process quickly so that I could get the Corvette. I don't think, as I said earlier, I don't think it's worth it, really. Unless you really, really, really want the Corvette or really, really, really want the Cutter, I would just recommend staying with the Anaconda. I have a couple of other ideas for future videos in this tutorial series, but in the meantime, I am planning on trying something new wherein I basically make just a silly build with some of my ships just for fun. To see how it goes. Somebody had mentioned they might want to see something like that in the comments. If you have any ideas for things you want me to walk you through, go ahead and leave it below. Otherwise, I will catch you guys in the next episode.